How should I configure virtual memory settings? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for AskLeo.com. Let's get right to this question. I have a Windows machine to which I added a second hard drive. The new larger drive is now the primary. What do you recommend for a swap file? The 3x RAM rule of thumb doesn't make much sense to me. It should be bigger with less RAM, not more. It's currently set to the same as my RAM size as its minimum and twice as much as a maximum size on the C drive. What size should I set it to? Should it be on a different partition, and should I give it its own partition? I'll be doing a lot of scanning and Photoshop if that affects the answer. It's my understanding that a fixed size reduces fragmentation, or at least makes defragmentation easier. I've also seen suggestions for making the swap file an entire partition. I have partition magic. Would putting it onto the second drive improve read-write speeds? The second drive will be for backing up data files and not in constant use. So you're asking some great questions and providing the right kind of information to be able to address some of the topics that you're raising. I've written about virtual memory a time or two already, but what I want to do in this article is go over what is essentially what is so much voodoo to many people and talk about what it is, why it is, when it gets used, and based on your situation, whatever specific that might be, make a recommendation on exactly where to go. So let's start with some terminology. Swap file, paging file, virtual memory, what the heck? Very, very technically, and I do mean very technically, they have different meanings. However, for the purposes of this discussion, we're just treating them all as the same. All they really are is disk space used instead of RAM. Now, RAM and disk are very, very different. So what that means is that when your system runs low on RAM, when programs are trying to use more RAM than perhaps your system has available at that time, Windows will take something that's in RAM and write it to disk, making that RAM available for whatever this upcoming need turned out to be. When it's time to come back, when that RAM that it just wrote to disk is needed again, well, then it might have to move something else out of RAM and read that virtual copy of RAM from the disk back into real RAM. Now, that's a gross oversimplification, but the important point is that when the system is in this situation where it is needing to use disk space as if it were RAM by writing to it and reading from it, the disk gets really busy. And it's a performance hit because your disk is slower than your RAM. That's why RAM exists, right? RAM is very, very, very fast. And the process of writing some of it to disk and then reading it back in later when needed, that's slow. So that's the very first thing that I would focus on when trying to understand what you should set your paging file, your virtual memory settings to. Virtual memory is a performance bottleneck only if your system has used up all available RAM. RAM matters most. So if you find yourself in that situation frequently, then I actually have two recommendations. Either add RAM to your system, if you can. If your system has the hardware capability of having you add more RAM to it, that by far will be your biggest performance improvement because you'll be able to continue doing what you were doing without necessarily needing to hit the disk because of paging. It'll all stay in RAM because you've got enough. The other option, try not to do as much at the same time. When you're running 5 or 6 programs or you've got a couple of dozen browser tabs open, all of those require some amount of RAM to run. That's the kind of stuff that can add up. And if your machine doesn't have a lot of RAM or if you're running a lot of different things at the same time, then that too can push you into this situation where all of a sudden your system as a whole requires more RAM than it actually has and Windows has to start swapping to and from the disk. So add more RAM if you can, use less RAM if you can't add more RAM by running fewer programs. Let's have a look on my demonstration system here, exactly what it means to potentially not have enough RAM or where to even look. So I'm going to go ahead and close the browser here because I don't really need it right now. I'm going to right click on the start menu and click on Task Manager. Task Manager is a useful tool for this kind of thing. I'm making it a little bit bigger on purpose, but whatever works for you is fine. If, by the way, you run into Task Manager and it looks like this, especially when you've got nothing running, make sure that you click on More Details because that's where all the good stuff is. Then where we want to look at is Performance, and here you can see Memory. So what we're looking at, that top graph is showing how much RAM is currently in use by the system. So you can see this machine has 4 gigabytes of RAM available, and it's using about 1.6. Why the available 1.2 doesn't add up to the 1.6 to be 4? That's a topic for another discussion, simply because Windows memory management is so much voodoo. Here you can see it actually says committed to of 3.5 gigabytes, so you know that it's got some amount of knowledge that there's 4 gigabytes available. If there's one takeaway, I will say, as kind of an aside here, Windows memory management is so much voodoo. It really is a lot of magic. Numbers don't add up. Things don't necessarily behave the way you think, especially when you're looking at reports like this. That's not a bad thing. Windows memory management is incredibly complex, and it's complex because it's really trying to do a best job it possibly can as providing the optimal experience in terms of memory usage. So don't let the fact that things don't necessarily add up matter too much. Don't let that worry you. Do take a look at what your system is using. Like in this case, I'm using 1.6 gigabytes, and more importantly, what's available, 1.2 gigabytes here of actual free RAM. If I fire up Chrome again, this time I'm going to minimize Chrome, and you can see that in fact, yep, it actually uses now a little bit more RAM. We've got less than a gigabyte available. Depending on what you're doing, obviously your numbers will be different. Depending on how much RAM is in your system, your numbers will be different. Depending on how many programs you're running simultaneously, your numbers will be different. This is a fairly stripped down machine, both in terms of RAM available, but also in terms of what I have installed. I'm not running that much. It's one of my cleaner example virtual machines for Windows 11. But that's where you look. If you suddenly see the available memory get small or zero, and by small, I mean, if you see it like bumping up here against the very top of the in use, a rule of thumb might be that of the actual memory installed, 4 gigabytes in this case, if you're starting to see it bump up to be less than a quarter of that or less than an eighth of that be available as free memory, you're running into a potential paging situation as soon as you run something else. So that's just something to be aware of in terms of memory usage and how Windows does it. So let's go change some virtual memory settings, or at least look at them. I'm right-clicking on Start. We'll click on System. And then in System, somewhere, is this Advanced Systems Settings. Click on that. Here you'll see that in the Advanced tab, in case that's not the default tab when yours comes up, you'll see something here called Performance, in which there is this virtual memory. We'll click on Settings. Once again, we have to go into a different tab. It comes up with visual effects. Feel free to play with those or not. We'll hit Advanced, and down here is the virtual memory setting. Now, total paging file size for all drives right now is 704 megabytes. If we want to change that, we would first turn off automatically managing the page file size for all drives. And then if we had multiple drives, we could select each drive individually and give it, if we wanted to, a custom size. Or you could say no paging file, and I'll talk about that here in a moment. But for the most part, letting Windows automatically manage the paging file for you is my general recommendation. It is absolutely possible to run without virtual memory. You can turn off the paging files. In fact, on my primary machine, the one that the companion article for this video has screenshots from, you'll see that it has a lot of RAM. It has 64 gigabytes of RAM, of which I tend to use maybe 16 or 20 gigabytes at most. It doesn't need a paging file. If I'm in a situation where that system is paging, something is very, very wrong because I've used 64 gigabytes of RAM and there's nothing that I do that will. So if you're in a situation where you have an excess of RAM, where you've got more than enough RAM to deal with whatever it is you deal with on a day-to-day basis, feel free to turn off the paging file. You save yourself a little bit of disk space. You might save yourself a little bit of speed, although I don't think it's really that big a deal when Windows isn't using an existing page file. Now, to your question about whether or not, if you're going to have a paging file, do you want it on a separate drive or not? The answer is yes and no. It's important that we distinguish between drives and partitions. It is counterproductive to put the paging file on a partition that is on the same physical hard disk as your system. So for example, if you've got a traditional spinning platter, magnetic hard drive, and you create a partition specifically for the paging file, you've made things worse because the disk head now is going to have to do a lot more movement to get to and from the paging file as your system runs. If you're running with an SSD, honestly, there's no point in doing that simply because it takes the same amount. There's no advantage to having a separate partition on the same SSD. Now, having it on a separate physical drive is another story. For example, if you have a C drive and a D drive, and C has your system and it's got the programs that you're running, putting the paging file onto your D drive instead can in fact increase performance, because rather than having the disk, a single disk, competing and moving all over the place to read and write the paging file while it's still trying to do whatever it is you're asking to do, you're spreading the load. You're spreading the load across two different hard drives with independent access mechanisms, which is great. That's a performance improvement. If you've got two SSDs, performance improvement probably not that great, but there actually still will be a very, very small one. But the bottom line is that not on the same hard drive, but as long as you can put it on a separate physical device, then yeah, moving the paging file can in fact be a net positive. You cannot, and I don't think Windows will even let you, move the paging file to an external drive, because that just doesn't make any sense. If you accidentally remove the external drive, bad things will happen. And it's going to be way slower, just because the external drive is probably going to be on an interface that is significantly slower than the interface used by internal drives. Finally, you asked about defragging the paging file. It's weird. There used to be a utility that Microsoft provided that would allow you to defrag the paging file. It's no longer available. It doesn't work in Windows 10 or 11. And honestly, there really isn't that much of a need to. There's two reasons for that. Defragging kind of assumes that files are accessed linearly. In other words, you're reading a file from beginning to end. You're writing a file from beginning to end. The paging file isn't really accessed that way. It's accessed pretty randomly. What that means, though, is that the optimization that puts all the pieces in order doesn't really help that much. There's really no huge gains to be had by defragging the paging file. Yeah, there are third-party utilities out there that can probably force the issue. That's fine, but you're not going to get a lot out of it. If I wanted to defrag my paging file, the way I would do it today would be to use one of my backup programs, either Macrium Reflect or ESIS to do, take a system image of this hard drive, and then restore it. Because since backup programs typically work file by file, when it restores files, they tend to be restored contiguously. In other words, they're defragged right from the start, including the paging file. So, but like I said, it's way not worth it. I don't recommend taking the time to do it, because you're going to waste more time doing it than you'll actually save for any perceived speed improvement. So I hope that helps. I hope that helps you understand a little bit more about paging files and what you may or may not want to use, set them to. In summary, if you can, make sure you have enough RAM. That way you never have to worry about it. If you do have to worry about it, I tend to recommend letting Windows do the work and do the worrying for you. And the only time moving the paging file actually helps is if you were to put it on a second internal drive. For updates, for related links, for comments, and more, visit askleo.com/3062. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is AskLeo.com. Thanks for watching.